Let me welcome you all. Thank you for coming. I'm very happy to introduce our speaker tonight with Vincenzo De Rizzo, coming from Max Planck Institute from Berlin. And this title of the talk, not entirely visible on the blackboard because we haven't been able to get rid of that first thing on the left-hand side, but anyway, the title is Doing an Axiom on the Mathematical Epistemology of Jerome Scheele. The rule of the house here is that it's 1 hour talk and 1 hour of discussions, but you know, feel free to do it the way you want.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me. So I would like to talk about Scheele this evening. Well, this is a topic which is connected with the masterclass on principles that is held at the Institute these days, with some overlapping for the people that were not there this afternoon. And well, it is a paper on, well, more on the history of mathematical epistemology than in the history of mathematics in a proper sense. And it is just one example, one case study, so to say, of what a theory of principles and axioms, what such a theory could do in the hands of a working mathematician, and what kind of really complex and strange theories about the nature of axiom might have been elaborated in the 17th and the 18th century. Well, you may know something about Scheele. He was he's especially known because he wrote, under many respects, the first treatise ever on non-Euclidean geometry. So he is a figure that has a prominent role in the history of mathematics, even though, so to say, by mistake. It is the short story of Scheele is that he, like many other mathematicians before him, was attempting to prove the parallel postulate. That is one of the most difficult things that one could do in the foundations of mathematics. And he attempted to give such a proof by a kind of reductio argument, that is, by demonstration, by reductio, that is, by assuming the falsity of the axiom, then deducing consequences from the falsity of the axioms in the hope of finding some contradiction that had proved that the parallel postulate is true and can in fact be proven from the other hypothesis of Euclid. And then he developed for many pages, some 300 pages, the consequences of the denial of the parallel postulate. And in doing that, with great smartness and ability as a mathematician, he in fact proved what we consider today some very beautiful and very exact and true theorems of non-Euclidean geometry, of hyperbolic geometry. And this was the first time in history that such theorems were proven. Then at the end of the book, he tried to close the book saying something like, well, and this is so absurd that it cannot be, so therefore the parallel postulate should be true. This book has a very, very strange history because he clearly wanted to secure the parallel postulate and Euclid's system of principles, and ended up in conceiving the first treatise ever on non-Euclidean geometry. So he's considered today a kind of genius, malgré lui, so to say, since he was able to do something really, really important in the history of mathematics without really wanting to do that. Notwithstanding the fact that Scheele is often quoted in the literature and in the histories of geometry and non-Euclidean geometry in particular, because this book is really, really important for the history of geometry, he is still not very well known. And in particular, well, his more philosophical and general views on what does it mean to prove an axiom, to prove the parallel postulate, this is why he was trying to do this kind of things, well, I was still not very, very studied and very clear. So what I would like to do this evening is just to try to give you some perspective on this kind of work. So just to begin, I will give you some general historical view. Sacchetti lived between 1667 and 1733. He was Italian, he was a Jesuit, and he was very much influenced by Jesuit science and mathematics at the time. He taught for almost his entire life in the University of Pavia in northern Italy, and for some years in Milan and some years in Turin. And he did not produce many mathematical works, many scientific works. In fact, these are the fourth books that he published while he was alive. The first, the Quisita Geometrica, are just a kind of useful dissertation. The Logica Demonstrativa is a much more important book, because in this Logica, he expressed, in fact, the whole of his epistemological ideas about mathematics, axioms, theorems, proving things, and so on. So this is a very important book to understand his properly mathematical work. And in fact, already in 1697, when he was 30 years old, in the Logica Demonstrativa, almost all the examples that he did about mathematical propositions come from the attempts to prove the parallel postulate. He was already involved in this kind of attempts. Then, many years later, he published the book on statics that had, that is not very good, in fact, but was however, celebrated at the time. You should consider that Sacchetti was rather well known while he was alive. For instance, Sacchetti's Neostatica was read in France widely, and in Germany as well. Leibniz quotes it in some of his letters. It is, at the time, he was a scientist with a certain degree of fame. But he was especially well known because apparently he was very, very smart, that is, as a person. He was, for instance, a world-renowned champion of chess, and things like that. Then every one of his correspondents say that he was, that he didn't like to work at all. So notwithstanding the fact that he was very smart, he produced just a few results in mathematics. In any case, for his entire life, he worked at the perfection of this proof of the parallel postulate. That is at least from 1693, but probably since he was a student in Turin, and he was not properly able to conclude his own studies, because of course he could not prove the parallel postulate. His most important book on mathematics, the one that presents several theorems in non-Euclidean geometry, the Euclid Vindicated from Every Blemish, from 1733, was published in the same year of his death. We do not even know whether he was able to see the book properly. We can imagine, since his biographer says that he was ill since many months, that at some point he realized that he was about to die, and so he collected together all the studies he was able to, well, if had been able to do in the past 50 years, and publish that as the Euclides of Omninego Vindicatus. It is even possible that the final version of the book is not his, but of some of his students or collaborators. We do not know that. Okay. Well, as for the thing that he was trying to do, well, you surely know that, but just to let you know, draw five postulates in Euclid's Elements, five geometrical postulates. We have seen this morning. Four of them are very easy, like between two points you might draw a line. And then there is this fifth postulate, which is extremely more complex than the other four postulates. And for this very reason, since antiquity, that is, since the time of Euclid himself, there had been people attempting to prove this postulate that could not be conceived as a proper self-evident principle of geometry. The postulate more or less says that if this two line was, say, inclined the one toward the other, if you extend them sufficiently, they will meet at some point. This is the statement of the postulate. So from an intuitive point of view, this is quite clear that it should be true. That is, if you extend that, they will meet at some point. But as you see, the formulation itself is rather more complicated than the other axioms and the other postulates, and therefore, well, it seems that it must require some kind of proof. It should be added that this postulate has a converse proposition stating that if two straight line are forming equal angles which are transversal, that is, imagine that this is a right angle and this is also a right angle, so they are in this kind of configuration, they do not meet. Now, this proposition, that is the inverse proposition of this one, can be proven in elementary geometry without assuming any postulate. So here you have also this strange thing that one proposition is a theorem and the inverse proposition should be a postulate, and this was considered from an epistemological point of view, from a logical point of view, an oddity that should have been solved by a demonstration of this possibility. They wanted to show that it could be proved and it was a theorem. A very important quotation for Sacchetti, that is from Henry Saville, who was an important humanist in Oxford, that is, you see that in the most beautiful body of geometry, there are two blemishes, two blots. And that is the theory of proportion and the fifth postulate, that is, this postulate here. This quote by Henry Saville was very famous at the time, and many people began to talk in the 17th century about these two blemishes on the beautiful body of Euclid or on the beautiful body of geometry. And that's from that the title of Sacchetti's work, Euclid Vindicated from Every Blemish, comes from. I should add that Euclid Vindicated from Every Blemish by Sacchetti is in fact a longer book than the one that I will present to you this evening, because it is in fact divided in two different books, one dealing with a pile of postulates and the other dealing with the composition of rationals and the problem of proportionality. So he addressed both points raised by Saville, which were in fact two very important foundational issues in the 17th century. That is, the theory of proportion was considered as still demanding some kind of refinement. And it was, moreover, very, very much important in the 17th century because on the theory of proportion, a great part of the new mechanics was grounded. So it was particularly urgent to reground the theory of proportion. And the fifth postulate that has escaped any attempt of proof since until the ancient times. I will just mention you a few people doing that because there are some important sources for Sake. You have a few Greek authors that attempted to prove the power of the postulate in antiquity. And the characteristic of these Greek proofs by Posidonius, Geminus, Ptolemy, Proclus, and Simplicius is that this kind of proofs of the power of the postulate are all very, very, very simple. That is, they had in mind that since the postulate is in any case a very basic statement, the proof of the postulate had probably to be very simple. And it is simple as one of the theorems on the first book of Euclid. That is, with a couple of passages, you should be able to prove that. And in fact, they gave some proof, some very short proof, some wrong proof, of course, because you cannot prove the postulate. But nevertheless, these ancient proofs of the postulate that we have are all very simple mistakes. The situation changed a lot in the Arabic Middle Ages. That is, Euclid in the Middle Ages was translated into Arabic, and several Arabic mathematicians were in fact engaging with foundational problems in the elements of Euclid. And this changed the field in the sense that these mathematicians were very much refined. They understood that the postulate could not possibly have been proved by easy methods, and in fact they began to devise some very complex proof of the power of the postulate, including the notion of divisible, some kind of proto-infinitesimal calculus, or mechanical consideration. That is, you find very rich and very long and complex wrong proofs of the power of the postulate in the Arabic Middle Ages. And one should add that a lot of good mathematics was discovered, in fact, by these authors in the attempt to prove the power of the postulate. While most of these Arabic sources will not be translated or published in the Western, in the early modern age, and so Sake could not have known them. One of them, this Nasir al-Din al-Tusi, who is a very late author, he gave a kind of abridgment of resume of all the preceding attempts. And Nasir al-Din al-Tusi's work, at some point arrived in Rome. This is a very complex story of manuscripts, but in any case, the Medici family was able to collect a lot of Arabic manuscripts, and they founded a publishing house in Rome with the hope that this Arabic manuscript could have been published in the 16th century. The person, the chief editor of this edition, one person called Raimondi, was not very good in doing that. So many of these manuscripts were not published. That is, among them, there were the 5th, 6th, and 7th book of the Conics of Apollonius that were not otherwise known in the West, that many, many mathematicians hoped to have, and wrote letters and letters to Raimondi, hoping that he had disclosed his treasures, but they were only published late in the 17th century by Borelli, after what, almost one century that they laid there in the library. The case of Narziva di Nastusi was more likely because in 1594, as you may say, the treatise was published. The title is Latin, but the book is in Arabic. It is just the top of it's in Latin. But nonetheless, the most important mathematician working in Rome at the time, Christoph Clavius, who was a Jesuit and the most important Jesuit mathematician of the Renaissance, well, he was working on Euclid. And in fact, Clavius published in 1574 his edition of Euclid, which is a wonderful edition, a huge edition, that collected together all the commentaries to Euclid that had been done up that year. It is a huge volume of some 2,000 or even 3,000 pages with a lot of corollaries, scholia, commentaria, and so on. And for almost 2 centuries, even 3 centuries, it remained the most important and scientific edition to study Euclid, even from an advanced standpoint. When Clavius in 1589 was able, well, in 1574, the first edition of Clavius, he relied on the Greeks' proof of the power of the postulate, but in 1589 he was able to read Nasir ad-Din through his Raimondi, and therefore he added a long demonstration of the power of the postulate that was basically taken from Nasir ad-Din. That was enormously important from the historical point of view, because since everyone read Clavius from that point on, all mathematicians in the 17th century and in the 18th century, first of all, they knew that there was a big problem in proving the power of the postulate, and second, no one of them thought that Clavius' demonstration was good, but they all understood that proving the power of the postulate has to be a very, very difficult task. That is something that the best Arabic mathematicians had attempted to prove for 5 centuries without success. And so this book by Clavius opened the rich season in the early modern age that produced the hundreds and hundreds of attempts to prove the power of the postulate, and well, almost all the most important mathematicians in the early modern age attempted at some point in their career to tackle this kind of problem with the most disparate, the most diverse techniques and abilities. It may be said, perhaps, to help what follows, that in Clavius' edition, there is also one very important mistake. That is, the proof of the parallel postulate, the statement of the parallel postulate is grounded, of course, in the notion of parallel lines. Now, Euclid defines parallel lines as lines which do not meet in the plane. However, since antiquity and in Clavius' commentary, you find that a few mathematicians defined parallel lines as a couple of straight lines which are equidistant to one another. And for instance, they say, if you have a straight line, the base there, then you put a segment at a right angle there, then you draw the segment along the line, the other point of the segment will draw another straight line. This second straight line is equidistant to the first, because there is also the same length of the segment between the two, and this line is in fact the parallel line to the first one. Now, if you start with a definition of a straight line as an equidistant line rather than a line that does not intersect the other, you can prove the parallel postulate from that very definition. And this was the cause of a lot of misunderstanding in early modern age, because many of these proofs of the parallel postulate were in fact relying on this alternative definition of parallel lines. What was wrong here is that you should prove that such lines, I mean equidistant straight lines, will actually exist or may exist. And this was seldom done. They just accepted the idea that you may have two straight lines which are equidistant. While in non-Euclidean geometry, if you take the equidistant line to a straight line, you find that this second line is not straight. It is a curved line. But given this argument by motion, which is very intuitive, of course, it seems to everyone that, if you do that kind of thing, what result there, is just another straight line. Clavius gives some intuitive argument while the superior line there should be straight as well. That this is not the case, you may understand better if you imagine, a straight line as a grid circle on sphere. You know that there is this kind of analogy, let's call it that way, between straight lines and grid circles in a sphere. Then if you take a meridian line, like the red one there, the meridian line is clearly equidistant from the equator, but it is not anymore a grid circle. And so it should be considered as a curved line on the sphere rather than another straight line. But this was very hard to grasp, and not even Sacchetti grasped that. Even though Sacchetti was able to debunk, so to say, this kind of reasoning starting from the equidistant line. We will see that in short. Okay, let me just mention very briefly a few sources of Sacchetti in the 17th century. There is a line of Jesuit people. Clavius himself was a Jesuit, so it is not surprising that Sacchetti, is addressing the proof of the parallel postulate starting from Clavius' work. But in the meantime, there were several, mostly French or Belgian, Jesuit mathematicians who published very influential works on Euclid and elementary geometry, producing their own proofs of the parallel postulate. These were, however, not very good. The proofs that were good, or in any case better, was the one coming from another line of sources of Sacchetti, that is the Italian school. these people, Borelli, Giordano, and Marchetti, are all disciples of Galileo in some way or the other. Well, as I said, they were especially involved in some kind of reformation of the theory of proportion, because the theory of proportion was needed to ground mechanics. But they also discussed the prior and postulate, and in particular, the work by Borelli and the work by Giordano are very, very good from the foundational point of view. None of them, of course, managed to prove the prior and postulate, but nonetheless, Giordano's Euclideo Istituto in particular is the best work, so to say, on the parallel postulate before Sacchetti. You see also that the titles here, Euclideus Restitutus, Restituto e Formatus, are very similar to Sacchetti's Euclideus Vindicatus from a few years later. It should be said that Borelli in particular was the main rival, so to say, of Sacchetti in Euclid Vindicated, because Borelli attempted to completely reform Euclid. That is, Borelli was convinced that there was not much good in the elements of Euclid and that they needed a complete reformation. And this is right the contrary attitude of Sacchetti. Sacchetti is an extremely conservative mathematician that wanted to show to the world, to the entire world, that not even a sentence in Euclid was wrong, and that everything in that work was absolutely perfect. So this work by Borelli is criticized all the time in Sacchetti's work, because while it was the most important and most influential work on Euclid, that attempted just to show that Euclid was wrong almost in every aspect of his work. And you have here some strange quotation about the fact that Borelli has called his book Euclides Restitutus, that is, restituted in some sense, because it was not restituted at all, that is, the Charles says that with difficulty one can find Euclid in Euclide Restituto, and this is not fair. He says that, well, the work by Borelli is not an Euclides Restitutus, but one Euclides mendax permutatus dirutus pervolutus, that is, completely destroyed in many, many which is true. Lastly, there is one last kind of sources for Sacchetti's work, that is the English tradition. The English tradition stemming from Savile, that is, from that quote on the two moles or blemishes on Euclid's body, and in particular, the work of one great mathematician, John Wallis, and one good philosopher but bad mathematician, that is Thomas Hobbes. Thomas Hobbes is relevant because, well, things were like that. When Savile died, he left a kind of endowment to Oxford University to have a chair in mathematics, the civilian chair of mathematics that is still active. And the aim of the civilian chair of mathematics was to remove the two bad blemishes on the bodies of Euclid, that is, to reform the theory of proportion and to prove the parallel postulate. So there was a first chain of civilian professor of mathematics that in fact tried to do these kind of things. And the last civilian professor of mathematics in mid-17th century was John Wallis. And John Wallis, at some point, engendered a very long and cruent dispute with Thomas Hobbes, in which Thomas Hobbes pretended to have done a lot of things in mathematics, including squaring the circle, and John Wallis rightly pointed out that he had been able to do nothing at all. But at some point, in answering to Wallis' criticism in his sixth lesson to the civilian professors of mathematics, Hobbes sketches a proof of the parallel postulate, which is one of the worst proofs of the parallel postulate that had been conceived in the early modern age, and concluded that I've done that business for which Dr. Wallis receives the wages. That is, he is taking my salary because I've proved that postulate that as a civilian professor, he should have done. Now, this provocation by Hobbes was important because, well, it engendered, in fact, Wallis' work on the fifth postulate that amounts to another proof of the parallel postulate, a new proof of the parallel postulate that concludes, well, you see, and with this proof, I have finally vindicated Euclid, which is, well, again, the title of Sakai's work, who was very well acquainted with Wallis' proof. Now, Wallis' proof is also very important from a general point of view, because what Wallis did was to prove something very important, that is, that assuming the parallel postulate is in fact equivalent to assuming the possibility of transforming figures by similarity, that is, to construct similar figures to a given figure in the plane. Right?
Which are not convex.
Yeah. Well, this is true, of course, and in fact, in non-Euclidean geometry, in spherical geometry, or in hyperbolic geometry, you do not have similar figures, well, if they are not just congruent to the figure itself. Now, of course, this was an important result, and Wallis claimed that this was a proof of the parallel postulate, because no one could ever conceive that given a triangle, you may not construct a similar triangle, a bigger or smaller triangle than the one that is given to you. This is something that for Wallis is so evident and so clear that requires no further explanation. He even gave a kind of metaphysical explanation of that. Wallis was a kind of Aristotelian, and he says, well, in the world there are several different categories of being, as you know. One is the quality, one is the quantity. These categories, in Aristotelian orthodoxy, are of course well separated, the one from the other. Now, in geometry, the quality of a figure is just the shape of a figure, say that kind of triangle. The quantity of the figure is its area or volume. Since these are different categories, of course, you may change the quantity of a figure, preserving the quality, or changing the quality, preserving the quantity, because there are different categories, so you may do things like that. No one was convinced, really, by Wallis' metaphysical reasoning, and in fact, Sakai, in one letter, says that, well, his proof is proved more with metaphysics than geometrical rigor. And so he had to go further. But nonetheless, the proof of Wallis was extremely important. Well, as we will see, the main point is that the proof of Wallis showed in some sense that the parallel postulate cannot possibly be considered as a postulate on parallel lines. That is, it points to some much deeper property that involves all possible figures in the plane or in space. And this had a very strong impact in the 18th century when people began to regard the parallel postulate and the attempts to prove the parallel postulate not just as a kind of foundational game in the theory of geometry, but rather as a kind of important metaphysical claim that had to be proven or disproven, but in any case, something that had to do with the deep structure of space rather than with the notion of a line or a parallel line. Now, coming to epistemology, this is something that I have already said this morning. You should know that proving axioms was a rather common thing in early modern age. That is, if you open Claudius's book, you find that after each of the axioms, Claudius offers his own proof of the axiom. This is of course very strange from our contemporary point of view, because what he was doing, that is, what does it mean that he proves all the axioms? And the point is that they had the idea that all axioms could be proven, in fact, starting from the definition of the basic geometrical entities. You have here one quotation by Hobbes that I mentioned before. That's for this common notion called axioms. They are, from the definitions of their term, demonstrable, although they may be so evident as they do not need any demonstration. That is, but in any case, you can prove them from the definition. This was also the opinion by Borelli that I mentioned before. And as I said in the morning, the only question was not much whether one could prove axioms from definitions or not, but whether it was worth to try to do that or not, because some people thought that since axioms are evident enough, we should not lose our time in attempting to do this kind of things. So, for instance, one French mathematician and philosopher and theologian Arnaud says that his first axiom is the parallel postulate, and then he says Euclid takes this proposition as a principle and with reason, because it is clear enough for being taken as such, and one should just one may just rompre la tête if he attempts to prove it. That is, it is evident enough, so don't waste your time in doing that. This notwithstanding, in this very same book, Arnaud offers a proof of the parallel postulate, which is more or less the same of Nasiruddin. That is, he still thinks that this can be done. He only thinks that it is not worth to do that, because this is clear enough. Well, Saccheri, sides with Clavius against Arnaud, that is, with the faction that thinks that you should prove all the axioms from the definition. So he says that axioms are also a proposition that are immediately clear from the understanding of the terms, that is, from the definitions themselves. These kind of propositions are the axioms. And so he So also that all the axioms, well, okay, let's say something more here. This general idea that one can prove axioms from definitions is important because, of course, things like the definition of a straight line as a couple of equidistant lines, well, these kind of definitions are those who allow you to do that. That is, you start with a definition that in some sense, in an implicit way, already contain the strength of the postulate, the strength of the axiom. And then, from that kind of definition, you can actually prove the parallel postulate. If you accept that there exists some equidistant line, because you assume that in the definition, then, well, you can actually prove the axiom, the postulate from the definition itself. So this is what was happening there. And against this kind of way of thinking, Sakari says that this kind of procedure has the disadvantage, of course, that you have to prove that such a equidistant line may exist. And if you assume that such a equidistant line do exist, in fact, we are assuming what Sakari calls, like all the scholastic, a real definition. That is, a definition that implies that something exists. And well, against this kind of procedure, Sakari says that all axioms should be formulated as referring to purely nominal definition, that is, definition that do not assume that something exists and must be proved from that. Then every nominal definition is good and cannot, what it is, if you assume that definitions are just stipulations of words and you do not assume that the defined object may exist. Well, therefore, you see that your epistemological program is changing. That is, in both cases, you have the idea that you can dispose of axioms because you may rely on definitions. But in the first case, you may rely on definitions because definitions are just, well, are just some kind of axioms in disguise, like the one of a equidistant line. If you say that definitions are just stipulations of words, and so, for instance, you cannot accept by definition that a couple of equidistant lines do exist, then geometry appears to you now a kind of Greek logicist program, that is, you are not starting from axioms or postulate because you are demonstrating them. But you are not even starting from definitions that are somehow given to you or that gives you the existence of mathematical objects, but just by stipulations of words. And therefore, you are starting from nothing at all. That is, you are starting just from the principle of contradiction and something like that. All axioms, with the exception of the two most universal axioms, these axioms are the principle of contradiction and well, a very similar logical principle that he discusses in the Logica. That is, well, his idea is that you only have, in fact, two most general axioms, say one, that is the principle of contradiction, and then everything else, the truth of every axiom and therefore every theorem of geometry, should only follow from the principle of contradiction, which is a very, very strong claim, of course. But there is something more. There is something more that concerns the idea of axiom. Because, of course, well, as I said, Sakai often says that he wants to vindicate Euclid in the sense of proving that everything Euclid says is good, is exact, is right. And then he attempts to prove the parallel postulate. Now, many historians here are wondering why he's doing that. That is, there is a very strong sense in which if Euclid is right, then a parallel postulate should not be proven because it is a postulate, not a theorem. And this is true, of course. And yet, Sakari was a very strange man. Sakari wanted, in fact, not only prove that the parallel postulate is true, but also prove that it can still be considered an axiom even though it is proved. This is even stranger. However, this was, again, somehow common at the time, in the sense that even when Clavius proved all the axioms of the elements of Euclid, you've seen the picture before, he did not claim that these axioms that are proven in this way were just transformed into theorems. He still claimed that they are still axioms. And it is difficult to say why in the case of Clavius. He says something like, their demonstration is so easy that they deserve not to be called theorems in the proper sense, and they should rather be classed among the axioms because their proof is rather immediate. One can try to fashion several more strict criteria, that is, if you prove a result just by definition, without construction or other axioms or theorems, this is an axiom. Or if you manage to prove a proposition without construction or without other axiom. But, well, if you look at Clavius' work in particular, none of these attempts really succeed. So there is a sense in which, in the end, Clavius' rationale to say that the axioms are still axioms, even though he proved them, well, he thought he proved them. It's just based on history, that is, Euclid had called them axioms, so I call them axioms, and they should be considered as axioms. And however, even though his criterion to distinguish a theorem from an axiom may be very sloppy and not very well done, Clavius thought that there was one exception, that is the parallel postulate. While all the other axioms that he proved should still be considered as axioms because his proofs are very immediate and very short, he realizes that to prove the parallel postulate, employs some 30 pages, 28 theorems, several additional axioms, several scholia, corollaria, and so on, even some consideration about infinitesimals. And so he concludes that in the case of the parallel postulate, it should be ranged among the theorems, really, not among the axioms, because its proof is so complex that it could not possibly be an axiom. And here is some dissatisfaction of Sakari. That is, he does not want this conclusion. Even though he might have been convinced that his Euclid vindicated from every blemish had in fact proven the parallel postulate, he was not satisfied with that, because if he had really proven the father postulate, he had not been negated in the proper sense. He had he had done some act of treason with respect to Euclid, because he showed that Euclid was wrong in assuming that as a postulate rather than a theorem. And so Sacchieri, who was a very peculiar man, constructed a huge epistemology aimed to show that he could give, in fact, a proof of the power of the postulate, still preserving it as an axiom, with the dignity of an axiom, and so to vindicate Euclid. And this is important even from a mathematical point of view, even though it starts with a strange epistemological claim. Well, the strange epistemological claim is that for Sacchieri, as I mentioned before, there are two kinds of axioms. There are the two most general axioms, like the principle of contradiction, and then there are all the kind of derivative axioms that are true just starting from the understanding of the terms and the definitions. So for instance, he thinks, like Clavius before him, that all the postulates and axioms except the power of the postulate are in fact this kind of axioms. That is, they are axioms because they are immediately proven from the definitions themselves. This cannot work, obviously, with the power of the postulate. Well, it didn't work for Clavius, but it doesn't work for Sacchieri either, because Clavius had a proof of 20 or 30 pages, and Sacchieri has a proof of 300 pages, so even less, this proof may be considered as immediate in any possible sense. And so he reverts to the first kind of principle, like the principle of contradiction. Well, the principle of contradiction obviously has no proof at all. It is what it is. This notwithstanding, Aristotle himself, who is of course a great authority for Sacchieri, gives a kind of proof of the principle of contradiction in book Gamma 4 of the Metaphysics. He gives an argument that is not properly a proof of the principle of contradiction, but it is an argument, well, a kind of dialectical argument. That is, the argument, well, it is much more complicated, but more or less is, if you deny the parallel, if you deny the principle of contradiction, then your words have no meaning at all, because you are not saying nothing sensible. If you want that you may say something that has a meaning, like the principle of contradiction is false, you are still distinguishing between truth and falsity. You are still giving some meaning of your word that is not the contradictory meaning of them. And so if you want to say something about the denial of the principle of contradiction, you are in fact endorsing the principle of contradiction. For that reason, you cannot never, ever deny the principle of contradiction itself. So this is a strange proof, of course. It is not a proof coming from principles. It is what Aristotle calls a dialectical proof. But in any case, it is a proof that has the peculiar structure that if you assume the contrary of the proposition that you want to prove, then you are forced to accept the proposition itself. In modern times, well, it is at the time of Sacchieri, this was not the only proposition that was proven in this way. Another proposition of that kind of structure is Cartesian cogito. That is, if you say, I think, then if you try to deny that, you have think, well, you have to think to deny that. So, therefore, if you try to deny the truth of the fact that you think, you are thinking, and so you are affirming the fact that you are thinking. This kind of procedure in the 17th century acquired a name in logic. It is the consequentia mirabilis. The consequentia mirabilis is this kind of inference that is from the denial of a proposition, that one, from the denial of a proposition, you can derive in some way the proposition itself. And this means that the proposition is true without further without further hypothesis. That is, if from not A it follows A, then A is true. That is, in some unconditional way. This kind of logical procedure is, of course, true even in our common extensional logic, when it is just a kind of reductio argument. That is, if you, from not A, you are able to deduce a contradiction, then not A is false and A must be true. And of course, you have there more or less the same thing, because it is from non-A you may deduce A, then you have A and not A, so you have a contradiction, therefore you must assume A. Things were much more complicated, of course, in the 17th century, because the inference part, that is, that arrow here, was not the material inference operator in our extensional logic, but was something much more complicated. That is, if there is a proof of something. And this is not something that we can easily formalize, of course. There are many attempts to do that, many different attempts to do that. And so in the 17th century, in fact, there was a quite lively debate whether the reductio argument and the consequentia mirabilis were in fact reducible to one another, or they were rather independent arguments. In any case, Sacchetti thinks that the consequentia mirabilis is not reducible to a reductio argument, and he thinks that the consequentia mirabilis is the argument that is in fact used to prove the principle of contradiction in some way. And so his idea is, well at that stage is simple. That is, I have to prove the parallel postulate through consequentia mirabilis. You see that? If I manage to do that, then I have proved not only that the parallel postulate is true, but even that it is an axiom. Because we have two kinds of axioms, those that immediately follow from the definitions, and this is not the case of the parallel postulate, or those such that their negation produces the contradictory statement, as the case of the principle of contradiction. And so Sacchetti's claim is that all the axioms of geometry except the parallel postulate are provable as axioms because they derive from definitions in some kind of immediate way, and the parallel postulate is true as the principle of contradiction itself is true. That is, you start by denying it, and then you have to prove that, therefore, it is true. If you manage to prove that, then you have proved the parallel postulate, of course, but you have also proved that it is an axiom rather than a theorem. Now, this idea that seems to be very strange, in fact, drives the entire structure of the book of Sacchetti. That is, at the beginning of the book, Sacchetti says that there are two different ways of denying the parallel postulate. One that he calls the obtuse angle hypothesis, that would be one kind of non-Euclidean geometry, what we call today spherical geometry, And the acute angle hypothesis, that is another kind of non-Euclidean geometry, that is the one that we call today a hyperbolic geometry. So to implement this program, he has to do not one, but two procedures by consequentia mirabilis in showing that the obtuse angle hypothesis implies the parallel postulate, and the acute angle hypothesis implies the parallel postulate as well. So in proposition 14, in fact, he managed to do to prove the obtuse angle hypothesis by both reduction and consequentia mirabilis. And this proof is true because, in fact, you may disprove spherical geometry starting from the other axioms of Euclid because, well, among those axioms, there is one axiom stating that the straight line may be arbitrarily extended, and this is false in the most common interpretation of spherical geometry. Then he goes on for many pages from proposition 14 to proposition 33, and this is the center of Sakai's work. That is, these theorems here are the real theorems on hyperbolic geometry. These are the theorems for which he is very well known today, and they are really, really amazing from the mathematical point of view. That is, he was able to prove results about asymptotic straight lines, for instance, using only ruler and compass constructions, without algebra, without infinitesimal analysis, just with simple Euclidean method. And all of these results are true in hyperbolic geometry. And this is something that not even Lobachevsky or Moyai had been able to do with the same exactness and insight. So this part of the book is really, really wonderful. And at the end of proposition 33, he arrives to think to have refuted hyperbolic geometry by an argument by reductio. Now, this argument is faulted, of course, because you cannot disprove the acute angle hypothesis, that is, you cannot prove the parallel postulate. However, the mistake here is just a kind of big no said by Sakai. That is, he arrived to prove all these fantastic statements in hyperbolic geometry, and at some point, one of them, he stops and say, of one of them, this is absurd. We cannot go further. And so there is no real mathematical mistake there. It is just a kind of epistemological or conceptual mistake of what we can accept or we cannot accept in mathematics. So properly, you can say that up to proposition 33, there is not even one mistake in Sakai's book. And then, however, even though he was convinced to have proven the parallel postulate in proposition 33, he had a second part of this book going from proposition 34 to proposition 39, but with a lot of scholia, so it is a long part of the book, in which he just attempts again to prove the parallel postulate, that is, to disprove the acute angle hypothesis, because he wants to prove it by consequentia mirabilis. That is, it is not. Yes, I think it is.
It's probably got some hot.
And this second part. Well, this second part is a real disaster. That is, in his attempt to prove the parallel postulate through consequentia mirabilis, he made a lot of mistakes, of gross blunders in mathematics. So this part of the book is really, really a failure. And So this is the structure of the book. It is completely informed by Sakai's epistemology and the theory of consequence and the obvious. Well, now it is late, but I would like just to say that well, a couple of things. One thing is that this passage through the consequentia mirabilis had some important mathematical consequences. That is, since the obtuse Hengel hypothesis, that is, spherical geometry, can in fact be disproved just based on the postulate saying that you can extend a straight line, there are some there are some mathematicians that do not even solve the possibility of having three hypotheses. That is, if you read Legendre's discussion on the theory of parallel, which is, well, some 60 years after Sakai, he only discusses two hypotheses. That is, Euclidean geometry and hyperbolic geometry. Spherical geometry is not discussed because it can be ruled out with a theorem implying just the notion of the extendability of a straight line. In Sakai's work, this cannot be, because since he wants to prove, well, to disprove the obtuse angle hypothesis by consequentia mirabilis, he has to use the theory of parallels, that is, he has to arrive from the obtuse angle hypothesis to Euclidean geometry. And therefore, he thinks, well, he's wrong, but he thinks, well, this is how proposition 14 works, but, well, in any case, he thinks that at some point he uses, well, he derives the fact that from the obtuse angle hypothesis, he may deduce that the parallel postulate is true. Now, this is not true. This passage is wrong. The final passage is true, but the middle passage is wrong. And this is important because through this mistake, that it is a kind of epistemological mistake and a logical mistake, Sakai said in any case that, look, there are two non-Euclidean geometries, two possible non-Euclidean geometries, the spherical one and the hyperbolic one. There is not just one. And this is extremely important because there will be a lot of discussion in the 18th century and in the 19th century of two geometries, not three. And it is only much later with the explosion of differential geometry, with Riemann mostly, that people begin to realize that in fact there are three geometries in the sense of Sakai. It is true. And it is much more, the view of geometry is much richer if we consider three geometry rather than two only. And there is in fact a line going from Sakai through a few other writers like Lambert up to Riemann that is different from the other line. A second thing that I would like to say before closing is that in this discussion of spherical geometry, Sakai never mentions the idea that what he calls the obtuse angle hypothesis is in fact a geometry that can be modeled on the surface of a sphere. We know that this is the case. that is, if you take a triangle in the obtuse angle hypothesis, the interior angle sum of a triangle will be higher than two right angles, greater than two right angles, and this is exactly the same thing that happens if you take a triangle on the surface of a sphere. So there are a lot of theorems that Sakari proves in the obtuse angle hypothesis that are just theorems of spherical geometry, theorems of how the surface of a sphere behaves. Now, these theorems were completely known in the 18th century. That is, Sakari knew them. And notwithstanding this, he never mentioned the fact that, look, what I'm doing here is some kind of spherical geometry. What I found here as the obtuse angle hypothesis is in fact the geometry on a sphere. And you see that this is grounded on the fact that he had still this epistemology that grounded all the axioms and all the results on definitions. That is, if you have to recognize that results on geometry may apply to the line drawn on the surface of a sphere, you have, of course, to change the epistemology of geometry. Because if you think that a straight line is a straight line, that is, that one, well, that kind of straight line, of course, cannot, well, it is not something that you can draw on the surface of a sphere. That is, the theorems that Sakari proves about straight lines in the obtuse angle hypothesis show that this straight line behave as grid circles on a sphere. But he cannot recognize that because he's dealing with straight lines, not with grid circles on a sphere. And everything should be grounded and based on his definition of a straight line, which is at the base of all the theorems and all the axioms of geometry. Just 30 years later, Lambert, who is another of the founders of non-Euclidean geometry, wrote one essay on the proof of the parallel postulate, attempting to prove the parallel postulate. And Lambert had a very different geometrical epistemology. That is, Lambert did not think anymore that axioms should be grounded on definitions, but he thinks that things are going the other way around. That is, you start with axioms, and these axioms are axioms about undefined terms. That is, you give some axioms on straight lines without mentioning what a straight line is. Then you collect all these axioms together, and from these very axioms, you get the definition of a straight line. That is, a straight line is something that behaves as these axioms say that it should behave. That is, in this respect, Euclid's postulates are, as it were, like so many algebraic equations already presented to us, such that we are to solve for x, y, z, etc., without our having to refer back to the thing itself. You have this kind of axioms that talks about things that you do not know what they are, like x, y, z, that you call straight lines, points, angles, and so on. And then once you have a complete list of axioms, of course, you may extract, like if they were some kind of equation, well, what is x? Well, x is something that has this, and that property, and this is a straight line. Now, if you go with this kind of epistemology on Sakari's result, as Lambert did, well, Lambert did not add any relevant mathematical results to Sakari's book. But in working the obtuse angle hypothesis of Sakari, with this new epistemology, he was able to see, look, you are doing here spherical geometry. And he could say that because, of course, he realized that a straight line in this context just meant some other thing. That is a grid circle on the surface of the sphere. So the change in epistemology here was extremely important. And this was the real step toward the discovery of non-Euclidean geometry. That is, toward the idea that, therefore, you may have a system of axioms different from the one of Euclid that would define some geometrical entities, and these geometrical entities may produce a very interesting geometry that can have, so to say, a certain model, a certain mathematical model. That in the case of the obtuse angle hypothesis was the surface of a sphere, and of course in the case of the acute angle hypothesis, that is hyperbolic geometry, was still a problem to find what kind of model could be. And this is the work of the generations of mathematicians in the 19th century. But at that point, you see that you can see clearly the possibility of alternative geometries, something that with Sakai's epistemology and the theory of definition, he could not possibly see. Okay, I will stop here, but in any case, to sum up, you see that there were some very, very strange epistemology of geometry in the 17th and 18th century, that there were many peculiarities, like this idea that axioms can only be proved through consequentia mirabilis because otherwise they would not be axioms anymore. That is, many things about how to discuss principles. And you also see that these very strange epistemological positions, on the one hand, produced some very good mathematics, that is, allowed Sakai to discuss the so-called obtuse angle hypothesis, something that no one else had been able to do because he was trying to use consequentia mirabilis. And on the other hand, this complex epistemological conception also prevented him, well, to properly see his own results. That is, that he had, in fact, proven things on the behavior of a line on the surface of a sphere, or possibly in hyperbolic geometry. Okay.
Thank you.
Presenting this as a kind of philosophical move, you're talking about a shift in sort of epistemic framework.
Yes.
Do you regard this as sort of necessary for the discovery of non-Euclidean geometry? That in fact it was like solving a philosophical problem rather than a mathematical problem. That the mathematical apparatus was there, but the mathematician wasn't able to take the next step. We were, in a sense, required a philosopher, or a philosopher of mathematics to usher it in.
This is, of course, a very bold claim, and we have no proof of the contrary, so it is difficult to say.
But I mean, that's how you seem to have set things up. I mean, the mathematical epistemology of Sakari. And
I think it played a very, very important role. It is, in the last couple of years, I worked through a reconstruction of the theory of parallels between Lambert's work and the work of Lobachevsky and Boyai and Gauss, that is some 50 years later. And I looked at all the attempts to prove the parallel postulate or to discuss non-Euclidean geometry just before the real statement of non-Euclidean geometry. And you find there that almost all of these works are involved in a very strong way with philosophy, with epistemology. That is, they are often, even the works of professional philosophers and mathematicians that at some point discuss this kind of things. And that this happened mostly in Germany. And, well, as I said this morning, it is deeply intertwined with the reaction to Kantian view of mathematics with the developing of Leibnizian programs in geometry or Lambertian programs in geometry. So I could definitely say that the literature that Gauss, Boyajo, Lobachevsky had under their eyes in the 1820s and 30s was largely a philosophical literature and an epistemological literature about the parallel postulate. Mm-hmm. More in general, what I would like to say is something that we have just touched here, is that what really changes, and this is the main topic of my research group in Berlin, is the interaction between philosophy of space and geometry. That is, classical geometry, but also modern geometry up to Lambert and Suss, had as its objects of investigation magnitudes or figures. That is, it was a geometry of triangles, of straight lines, or parallel lines, or conic sections, and whatever. That is, the object of geometrical investigations are the single figures. If you read Euclid's Elements, you find no traces of all of the notion of space. That is, it is never mentioned. What ancient geometry and Renaissance geometry and early modern geometry discuss are just figures, possibly figures in space, but in any case, figures and never space. This changes slowly in the 18th century. I think that the first one to say that geometry has to do with the structure of space itself was Leibniz, who still did not conceive any kind of alternative geometry, but nevertheless, he thought that, well, as you know, Leibniz called space as an order of situation that is a kind of structure. And since space for him is a structure, like for Newton, for instance, is like an attribute of God or something like that, since for Leibniz space is a structure of some kind, this structure may have geometrical properties. And therefore he thought that geometry is in fact investigating the very properties of space itself. Now this idea continued in the 18th century, and especially in Germany in the 18th century, because there Leibniz's ideas were widely developed. And it was not unchallenging. And it is, there are a lot of mathematicians that still consider in the 18th century, geometry as the science of figures. One of them, that was not in Germany, but one of them is surely Sakari, that in his whole work never mentions space. That is, he never discusses the idea that the researches that he was doing, that he was carrying on, had anything to do with physical space, with the structure of physical space. He never thought something like that. The researches that he was trying to do were researches on the notion of parallel lines, that is, on two straight lines. And then what happened is that, on the one hand, in Germany, you have this Leibnizian idea that geometry is the science of space, in the proper sense. And on the other hand, and this is the case of Lambert, you have also the idea, you have Wallis proof that I mentioned before. That is, Wallis proof was clearly a shock for many mathematicians and epistemologists post-Leibnizian, because Wallis proof showed, that the parallel postulate pointed to some kind of deeper structure. That is, the possibility of transforming any figure in a similar figure. Now, it is not possible to say that this property is a property of a triangle or a property of a conic section. nor even a property of a parallel line, of course. This must be some deeper property that grants the very possibility of drawing figures, and therefore Lambert clearly recognized it as one of the properties of space, conceived as a structure that has geometrical properties in itself. And this passage is really important. This is a huge conceptual passage, and you see also that the theory of axioms and definitions just follows this kind of line. This line of arguments. If you think that geometry is about triangles, squares, circles, or conic sections, it is obvious that the principles of geometry will be definitions. That is, the definition of a triangle or a square or a conic section that gives you the essence or the meaning of that kind of things. If you think that the object of geometrical investigation is space itself as a structure, then, well, it is still possible to think that what you are investigating is the definition of space. And this is more or less what Leibniz thought. But nonetheless, it is much easier to think that, in fact, you can define space, well, as a structure, through a system of axioms in that sense. That is, through a system of proposition, exploring and expressing relations between objects that you can draw in space that you do not even need to know what they are. That is, a system of axioms is the proper way to ground the structure, while a system of definitions is the proper way to ground a geometry of figures. And so, well, it is when Lambert realized through his readings of Leibniz and through his work on Wallis proof that in fact geometry is the science of space and space is a structure, something that he denied when he was young, well, he converted, so to say, of this new conception of geometry, and he produced this idea of how one could axiomatize and give the principles of geometry. And at that point, of course, if you think that the object of geometry is space, it is not so difficult to think that there might be different spatial structure. While if you think that the objects of geometry are triangles and conic sections, well, it is even difficult to understand how one could conceive a non-Euclidean geometry in the proper sense. You should have triangles that have different properties, but also conic sections that have different properties. That is, these things are not anymore separated one from the other with their own essence, but it is clearly, well, the whole picture that it is changing. And this can be done if you think that what you are changing there is the space structure. So in this sense, it is not surprising that before this epistemological revolution, that was really an epistemological revolution in geometry, no one had conceived any kind of non-Euclidean geometry, and that they are conceived just when this kind of new view on what the object of geometry is take place.
I am a bit puzzled because I don't understand why do you say that this shift comes with Wallis, as Wallis puts an existential result. There exist two similar non-congruent triangles and proves that this is equivalent to the fifth postulate. It was known already another kind of existential result of this of similar type. Fifth postulate is equivalent with denying fifth postulate is equivalent with saying there exists a triangle which sum of angles is different from two right angles. It's the same thing. And Sacchieri himself has another equivalent statement. There exists a Sakiri rectangle which is not a rectangle. Say.
Yes.
So it's the same thing. It's no need of Wallis here.
Well,
I mean, they are on the same plane, I think, epistemologically. And still, Aristotle says that in principle, the sum of the angles of a triangle could be different of two right angles, but this is not intuitive, so we don't like it. Roughly, that is what he says.
Yeah. Well.
So it is about space.
Of course, from a mathematical point of view, you are right. But what I think they were perceiving was not. Well, I don't think they were perceiving it properly as an existential claim. It is they were perceiving it as a general, the possibility of doing some transformations. It is the point is not that exists a triangle similar to a given one, but that I can transform this triangle into a similar one. It is
a dynamical sense.
Sorry?
A dynamical sense.
In a dynamical sense?
Yes, yes, in some kind of dynamical sense. So, well, discussing what existential claims are before the second part of the 19th century is very difficult because they do not really have existential statements in a refined and theorized way. They have this idea of transforming things, and for instance, Leibniz, when discusses this kind of things, again he thinks that the parallel postulate shows you some kind of property of space, because the example that he gives is that you may shrink the entire universe in a very small piece of matter, and no one would notice it. It is everything is shrunk, and therefore nothing would change. Now, this is what he says in the famous Leibniz-Clark correspondence on the nature of space against Newton. In his writings on geometry, he reconnects that to the power of the postulate. And so, you're right, of course, from a mathematical point of view, you're right. But if we try to understand what they were seeing in this Wallis result, well, it was something more like to that. That is, I can transform things. And if I can transform things, this possible cannot be possibly on one single thing or one class of things, but on all things together, that is the entire universe or whatever figure I can draw. And under this perspective, well, it could not be a property of a single figure, but it has to be a property of space itself. I think they saw the thing in this way, but yeah.
I mean, it's a claim. Just the historical tipping point was Wallace's result. There were other things there, but as it turned out, that there was Wallace's result that was the sort of the catalyst to
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this is really just a contingent historical claim about how we got to Sakiri, rather than a claim that, you know, that Wallis was the first one to get something that had implications for non-Euclidean geometry. Okay.
Thank you.
He was also one of the first to link together some metaphysical questions about quality, quantity, and so on, and the parallel postulates, so that, well, at that point, a discussion on the parallel postulate could not anymore be restricted to logicians and epistemologists of mathematics, but became some problem for the metaphysicians themselves. And this was an important change, because of course.
Yes, I would like to come back to this shift from a geometry of figures to a geometry of space, and ask you what does this concept of space mean in Lambert? And I'm asking this because I remember a text by Wolf from the early 30s, I think,
where he says that we should necessarily differentiate between the mathematical space and the metaphysical space, and never take the mathematical concept of space and transfer it to metaphysics because it's very bad and we make errors and so on and so forth. So does Lambert have a unified conception or notion of space?
Yes, he had one, and he insists very much on this. Well, you know that the main point of the difference, well, the dispute, so to say, between him and Kant is just that for Kant, mathematics and metaphysics has to be quite separated to one another, as for his methods and so on, while Lambert still thought that since mathematics is working so well, we should do metaphysics in the same way in which we do mathematics.
Which is the Wolffian tradition.
Yes. And so he still thought that any kind of separation here is very dangerous. However, his position is really complicated because the idea that I mentioned now, that is that geometry should be grounded on axioms rather than definitions and so on, it is not his constant idea. It is an idea that arrives at some point, and in fact arrives when he has to prove the parallel postulate and studied Wallis proof. That is, you find letters, well, it is Leibniz's idea that geometry should be the science of space was received in Germany well by some Leibnizians and very bad from some other philosophers. And the reason was that Leibniz had in fact worked out some papers on the geometry of space, the papers that he called the analysis situs. That is, he worked at this project for the whole of his life. He wrote some 3,000 pages on the analysis situs as a new science of space. That is, a new kind of geometry was object, was the structure of space itself. But he was not able to publish anything of these things. That is, he tried to involve Huygens in this project, and Huygens wrote him a very, very bad letter saying, why you are wasting your time in doing that, you are so good in the calculus, do that, don't do geometry at all, you are not very good at this. So it was very discouraging. Then he found a collaborator, but then this collaborator died just after a few months. Then it is, for a series of contingencies, and also for the fact that he had never been really satisfied with his essays on geometry of space, notwithstanding the fact that they were rather good, he never published anything about that. So what happened in the 18th century is that a few philosophers knew that Leibniz had conceived geometry as the science of space, and that space has a geometrical structure. But no one of them had the faintest idea of what this new geometry should be. So, for instance, if you take Wolff himself, well, at the beginning of the Anfangsgründe, he says that Geometrie ist der Wissenschaft des Raumes, geometry is the science of space, and then, as if he had said nothing at all, he begins with the theorems of Euclid, that is, how to construct a triangle, that is, all the theorems of Euclidean geometry, that is, the theorems on figures themselves, because he was not a good mathematician, well, at least a good mathematician enough to try to envisage some new kind of geometry. So this remained just a kind of philosophical statement. The same happens even much later, that is, in the dispute of the Leibnizian Eberhard against Kant. Eberhard says, the conception of Kant of space as a form of intuition is completely wrong, because Leibniz has told us, or shown us, that space is just a structure. Of course, this changes nothing in geometry. He added immediately this kind of proposition, which is rather outstanding. That is, Leibniz had thought, well, he is mad, because everything changes in geometry. But in any case, since no one had the faintest idea of what to do with the geometry of space, some of the best mathematicians in the 18th century, in fact, including Lambert, for a long time fought against this Leibnizian idea. That is, this Leibnizian idea was embedded in Wolff's work, and you find, for instance, letters from Lambert to Kant from 1765, saying, Wolff thinks that geometry is the science of space. This is completely wrong. By analyzing the concept of space, you cannot do anything in geometry. And Wolff has completely misunderstood Euclid, that it did not start from the notion of space, but rather from the notions of figures. I think that geometry, well, in Lambert's word, should not be the analysis of the concept of space, but rather the anatomy of space itself. The anatomy of space itself means that you should cut figures in space and study that figures there, triangles and so on. And Kant, in 1765, still agrees about that. He says, yes, you're right. That is, they were both anti-Leibnizian and anti-Wolffian epistemologists in geometry in 1765. In 1766, well, a few months later, Lambert writes his Theorie de Parallelinie. He does not manage to prove the parallel postulate. That is, he tried and tried and tried, and was not able to do that. And in doing that, he worked on Wallis proof through similarity. In 1771, that is a few years later, he published his new work on metaphysics, the Anlagezugang Tectonik, and there is a section on geometry in which he gives the axioms and postulates of geometry as he gives also the parallel postulate, because he hadn't been not able to prove it in his Theorie de Parallelinie. And he gives this axiom in the form of Wolff, in the form of Wallis. That is, he doesn't say two straight lines will meet at some point, but he says you can construct similar figures, you can transform similar figures in space. And at that point, he had changed his mind. That is, he had realized that, in fact, space has a kind of structure, that these axioms are not axioms on straight lines or triangles or other things, but are axioms on space itself. What it is, his entire epistemology changed in working through the parallel postulate and through Wallis proof. So you have to pay attention, so to say, in which works of Lambert you see, because if you look at this before 1766, you will find some kind of epistemology of geometry. After that, you will find another kind of epistemology of geometry, which is rather different that kind of thing.
Pressing questions, we can move and have a beer together. We can move to a German beer house called Siegfried, and we will walk there together. So please feel free to join us in this. But first, let's thank Vincenzo for a very long day and a very good two talks.